Let's review what we know about the Taylor series for some common functions. So, we already know a geometric series. We know the series for 1 over 1 minus x, and if we replace minus x with x with minus x, we get the series for 1 over 1 plus x. And then we said, hey, we can integrate that term by term, and that gave us a series for the natural log. And we could take the derivative of the series of 1 over 1 minus x, and we got the series for 1 over 1 minus x squared. And we took the integral of the series for 1 over 1 plus x squared to get the series for arctangent. And all of these were pretty much based on this geometric series and tricks taking derivatives and integrals. And they're good tricks, but it would be nice to have a systematic way to get the Taylor series for any function. Well, the theorem from the last video gives us that systematic way. So we're in this video, we're going to compute the Taylor series for a bunch of other functions that are not related to a geometric series. So remember what Taylor's theorem said. It said that if you have an analytic function, that is, if there is a power series representation of your function f of x, then the coefficients are just given by the nth derivative at a divided by n factorial. By the way, in all of the examples that we're going to do in this video, we're working around a equals 0. So we're just going to have powers of x, not powers of x minus 3 or x minus 5 or x minus 7. Okay, so let's start with e to the x. And we're just going to do our calculations at x equals 0. Well, the function is e to the x, and if you evaluate that at 0, you get 1. So our coefficient c0 must be 1. If you take the derivative, well, that's still e to the x. The derivative at 0 is 1. And so c1 is that divided by 1 factorial, which is 1. Second derivative is still e to the x. At 0 is 1, so the coefficient is 1 over 2 factorial. And you can keep going, and you find out that no matter how many derivatives you take, the function is still e to the x. The value at 0 is still 1. And so the coefficient is the value at 0 divided by the kth factorial. And so that's 1 over k factorial. Boom. We've got the power series for e to the x. It's the sum of x to the n over n factorial. Our coefficient, the nth coefficient is 1 over n factorial. The kth coefficient is 1 over k factorial. The nth coefficient is 1 over n factorial. Multiply by x to the n, and there it is, 1 plus x squared over 2, plus x cubed over 3 factorial, plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial, and so on. And if you apply the ratio test to this, you can see that the radius convergence is infinite. This series converges to e to the x, no matter how big or how small x is. While we're at it, we can apply the same sort of tricks we did with geometric series, because if e to the x is 1 plus x squared over 2 plus x cubed over 6 and so on, then e to the anything is 1 plus that anything squared plus that anything over 2 plus that anything cubed over 6, 3 factorial. And in particular, you could apply it to 2x. Boom, we've got the series for 2x. We don't have to take derivatives of e to the 2x over and over and over again. We could if we wanted to. It's not that hard. But you can just take the series for e to the anything and say a equals 2x. 2x, 2x squared over 2, 2x cubed over 3 factorial, and so on. If you want the series for e to the x squared, you just plug in a equals x squared. 1 plus x squared squared over 2, plus x squared cubed over 3 factorial, and so on. So these functions, I mean, you could just take derivatives of e to the x squared over and over and over and over and over again, but that's harder. It's much easier to say, we've got the series for e to the anything, x squared is a perfectly good anything, plug it in, there's the series for e to the x squared. How about sine of x? We want trig functions. Sine of x is a little bit trickier. The function is 0 at the origin, because sine of 0 is 0. The derivative is 1, because the derivative is the cosine. The second derivative is minus sine, and so that's 0 again. The third derivative is minus cosine. Well, that's negative 1. The fourth derivative, now we're back to sine. And it cycles through. The fifth is going to be cosine. The sixth is going to be minus sine. The seventh is going to be cosine. In general, you go through a cycle of four things. The fourth, eighth, 12th, 16th, 20th, any multiple of four derivative will give you sine. Evaluate it at zero, you get zero. And this coefficient is going to be zero. The next one is going to be cosine. The derivative is 1, so you get 1 over that factorial. 2 sine 0, 0. 3 minus cosine negative 1 over the factorial. You put it together and you get pluses from all the first, the fifth, the ninth, and so on. You get minuses from the third, the seventh, the 11th, and so on. So it's x minus x cubed over 3 factorial. X to the plus x to the fifth over 5 factorial minus x to the ninth over 9 factorial. The sign flips because every two derivatives sends you from positive to negative to positive to negative to positive to negative. And again, you can apply the ratio test to this, or you can apply the root test to this, and you get that the radius of convergence is infinite. This series works for absolutely all values of x. If you want the series for cosine, well, you could do the same game, talk about cosine, derivative of derivative cosine, and evaluate things, but it's easier to just say cosine is the derivative of sine. So you just take the derivative of the series that we had for sine, take derivative co term by term. The derivative of x is 1. The derivative of x cubed over 6 is x squared over 2. The derivative of x to the fifth over 5 factorial is x to the fourth over 4 factorial. Derivative of x to the seventh over 7 factorial is x to the sixth over 6 factorial. So by taking derivatives term by term, we get the series for cosine. Again, radius of convergence is infinite. The series works for all values of x. Now let's talk about powers. How do we get express 1 plus x to the kth power? And for this, the interesting cases are not when k equals 3 or 5 or 7, because then you could just multiply it out. The interesting cases is where k is either negative or is a fraction. So if k is a half, we're talking about the square root of 1 plus x. So let's work it out. The function is this, plug in 0, you get 1. The derivative, you get one fewer power and you get a k out in front. So the derivative at 0 is k. The second derivative is k times k minus 1. The third derivative at 0 is going to be k times k minus 1 times k minus 2. And the coefficient, you get that by dividing by the relevant factorial. So if you were to take, say, m derivatives, the mth derivative is going to be k times k minus 1 times k minus 2 down to k plus 1 minus m, m terms. You evaluate that at 0. You just get the product of these terms. And so the coefficient is going to be given by this expression. You start with k and you go down by 1, by 2, by 3 until you have k terms and m terms, and you divide it by m factorial. This is sometimes called k choose m. If k is an integer, it's k factorial divided by m factorial times k minus m factorial. The important case, though, is where k is not an integer. We'll still use this notation, k, parentheses with k upstairs and m downstairs, and that always means this product. Okay, so what we have is that 1 plus x to the kth power is the sum of k choose m, x to the m. In particular, if you apply that to the square root function, well, the first term is 1 half, the next term is 1 half times minus a half over 2, The next term is 1 half times minus 1 half times minus 3 halves over 3 factorial. The term after that would be 1 half minus 1 half minus 3 halves minus 5 halves over 5 factorial. Sorry, over 4 factorial. And if you actually write out what the first few terms are, it's 1 plus x over 2 minus x squared over 8 plus x cubed over 16. That's enough for now.